As we discussed last week, the Amazon unionization effort in Alabama obviously didn't go the way union advocates wanted. But there's a lot more to the story, both about what the actual conditions were like in that area, some of the tactics used by Amazon to try to pressure workers to turn against the union. And joining us now to discuss a number of different topics is writer and public policy attorney, returning to the show once again, Malika Jabali. Welcome back to the Damage Report.
Hi, John. Thanks for having me.
Glad to have you back on. As we were talking about before the show, you're actually doing similar sort of work right now. So there's definitely a consistent theme to your work, and we appreciate you taking time out to join us.
No problem.
So you actually visited the warehouse in question. Can you tell us a little bit about that experience?
Yes, I really was trying to capture kind of a day in the life of what some workers have to experience. And I wasn't trying to, you know, see what were the most sensational stories. I think people know the most egregious conduct that Amazon workers have had to face. But what are some of the little nuances and daily annoyances that enter people's lives? So I was actually in Atlanta around the last day of the vote. So the last day was on March 29th. That was the last day they were going to be accepting the ballots. And right when you pull up, there is a officer who's at the gate. So they've got a cop car that's right at the gate. There's another cop car that goes around and patrols the parking lot. They have private security that comes and they check people's license plates or just to look for random traffic violations. So there's always this, not always, but for the day that I was there, the afternoon that I spent there, there was a sense of constant surveillance. And when I went towards kind of where some workers were congregating, I just wanted to ask them, you know, what do you think about the status of things? How do you feel about it? A number of people I was surprised were open to talking to me. There are reports that, you know, younger workers there are more reticent about the idea of a union. But I had people who were very animated about saying, absolutely, we need something done here. And these are folks who are like under 30, under 35. Yeah. So they're just like little daily nuisances that I think people don't necessarily think about when it comes to some of this work.
Interesting. Yeah, so look, in the wake of the vote, you know, obviously it didn't go the way I might have preferred. I can only speak for myself that I would have preferred. So I've been trying to work through what are some of the potential influences on that. You know, is it growing up with a lifetime of anti-union propaganda? Is it particular concerns with the union in this case? Is it that the working conditions aren't as bad as they've made out to be? So you mentioned the surveillance. Did the workers that you speak to, were they satisfied with the way they're treated, their scheduling, the conditions and benefits and all of that?
Of the people who opened up to me, not a single person said that they were satisfied with, you know, that they were content with the way things were. The most I got was, it's okay. Universally, from, again, from the people who were willing to talk, they were concerned about the shifts. You know, they work 10-hour shifts. They might get 2 30-minute breaks. And I think for some Americans, like, that's perfectly normal. That's great. And that should not be considered normal activity. Because the problem is, especially if you only get, some people are saying, even if it's just a 1 hour break where it's condensed together, like, that's better than 30 minutes. In 30 minutes, you can barely even go outside of the parking lot. And so most people don't. They go outside, it's the Alabama heat. 68 degrees is nothing, but when you're sitting in your car, that thing heats up. So it's actually, it feels hot. Under an Alabama sun, you're out in the air, it is hot. So you have to go to your car, you have to run the gas. So that's even more, you know, more expenses that you have to think about. And you can only just roll up your windows, turn on the AC, sit there, and then come right back. Because by the time you get out to that large parking lot and walk back, that's already like 10 minutes right there. So there's barely any time. So they said even if they had an hour, like, that would be beneficial. So most people talked about the breaks, being able to have like a longer break. And if you don't mind, I'm actually at another organizing base right now. I'm in Joliet, Illinois. And so I'm with a group of warehouse workers. This is their first training day. They're awesome. Learning how to organize other workers. So if you hear noises in the background, that's them doing their orientation session.
No worries.
Yeah. Everybody I talked to was open about improving the conditions.
And what about, you implied that there were some that you spoke to that were against the unionization. What were some of the reasons that were given from the people that you were able to talk to?
Well, I didn't, it wasn't necessarily that they were against unionizing. a few people that I spoke to said they just didn't have enough information. Where they might have gotten a call, but they're, you know, when people are getting calls in the evening, like you're kind of winding down from work. You don't necessarily want to hear a spiel. So it's my sense is that some of it just probably took a little bit more contact. There's this really, really great article. I would suggest people read it, called The Blowout in Bessemer. That's the main heading, and it's by Jane McGallivy. It's in The Nation, and it talks about some of these like small like organizing things that end up being big. So door-to-door campaigning, something that she talked about, is really important. And because of COVID, people are reluctant to, you know, reluctant to go out in the field, but that's really kind of what it takes. So if you're just doing these house calls and not necessarily going to people's homes and saying this is important, it might just slip past people's fingers. So it's not necessarily antagonism. Some of it could just be apathy in a way, and you're doing other things.
Yeah. Yeah, no, well, I know in the wake of the vote, even before the vote was finalized, some of the activists were saying they're going to be appealing the vote. They talked about the pressure that was put on workers, and maybe, you know, a bit of that we got into with the sense of surveillance, as if an Amazon facility needed you thinking about that there might be surveillance on top of their normal technology. Were you able to talk to any of the organizers? Is it possible that the sort of advice that you were just giving there might be incorporated into some sort of follow-up effort to try to unionize later on?
I'm trying to get in touch with the organizers. I attempted to before I left out. Of course, you know, they're right in the middle of a campaign, so it was a little bit difficult to nab them on their strategies. But this is like ongoing work for me. I've been shadowing and reporting on warehouse workers for, I would say, about 2 years now. I first came to Joliet, the city that I mentioned earlier. It's in Will County, which happens to be probably the largest logistics center in the country. So there's a lot of railways that intersect here. And because of that, there's like a history of doing like warehousing and warehouses in this region. So this is like an ongoing project for me, and I will update you when I you know, talk to those organizers and see what their next steps are, because that is my next step.
Well, last question for you, and just, you know, this is, as you say, this is an area that you've worked in for a couple of years, something that you obviously, you know, care quite a bit about. Were you surprised at how it turned out in Bessemer? Did you expect that they would vote for unionization?
I was leaning towards this being it being surprising if they did vote for it. I'm from the Deep South. The right to work propaganda is big in the South. We've been hearing, you know, since I was a kid, that you need to be able to attract businesses down there, and there's so much land. And so Atlanta, for instance, which is only about 2 hours away, about maybe 2 to 3 hours away from Birmingham, this region attracts so many businesses, and we've had so many Fortune 500 companies because that's what we're told is the economic engine. You have to make it friendly for businesses. And if there's propaganda that you won't have a job at all, like let alone a job that doesn't really give you breaks, then that's going to be a disincentive for some people. So it wasn't a big surprise to me, understanding the tradition, even teachers in the South. My mom's is a school teacher. In the midst of COVID, like, they had difficulty wanting to organize about not going back to school because it's a right to work state and they don't have teachers unions.
Yeah, a lot of issues, obviously making it difficult down there. Hopefully the unions are incorporating this, but we appreciate you joining us to tell us about your experience. You know, depending on what you find in your current operation that you're on right there, maybe we'll talk again soon.
Yeah, and I just want to shout out one of the warehouse workers I've been, who I started talking to actually 2 years ago, Mark Ballantyne. He had a great interview in Jacobin. I recommend everybody read it. They basically just quoted him word for word, and it really gives you a sense of some of the egregious nature of like the anti-organizing work that companies like Amazon and other Fortune 500 companies do against these workers.
Awesome. Malika Jabali, thank you again for joining us. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, John. Take care.
For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.